Well, dear friends in Christ, grace to you and peace. Amen. One of the common pursuits in life is to want to be happy, right? I mean, life, liberty, and a pursuit of happiness is guaranteed us in the Declaration of Independence. It's an inalienable right, which we say, which we were given by our Creator to be happy. And over the years, I've heard from countless people, I just want to be happy. And there's nothing wrong with that. In fact, being happy keeps us from having unhappy days. It's not a good thing to have unhappy days. I mean, it's an unhappy day when you get up in the morning and put on your pants backwards and they fit better. It's an unhappy day when your twin sister forgets your birthday. That's an unhappy day. It's an unhappy day when your four-year-old says, Mom, it's almost impossible to flush a grapefruit down the toilet. It's an unhappy day when everybody says your driver's license picture looks just like you. Unhappy day when you go to the doctor and he says, well, you're really doing well for in fine health for someone twice your age. Those are just, you know, kind of unhappy days. And when you have days like that, it's easy to kind of think, all I want to do is just be happy and all of the troubles of the world will fade into oblivion. What I have found and what I think is that the problem with that is that happiness depends on happenings. Happiness depends on something external. Happiness comes from the word hap, which means luck or happenstance or good fortune or positive circumstances. Happiness comes from something external, but joy is something internal. Joy is something different. Joy is based on choice. Happiness might be based on chance, but joy is based on choice. Happiness is in chance, joy is in choice. Now, today we're concluding our June-July sermon series on seven secrets of a meaningful life, and we're ending with the secret of joy. And I think the secret of joy is so important because you need joy in your life. You just plain need joy in your life. It's not something just casual thing that it would be nice to have. Rather, joy is a fundamental emotional need that we have because without joy, life is too overwhelming. Without joy, life can just be burdensome. Life without joy can be oppressive. Studies have shown that the more joy you have in your life, the more productive you are. When you have joy in your life, you have more energy, you have more creativity, more productivity, more sense of satisfaction about life. When you have joy in your life, your whole body works itself together to overcome obstacles, positive and negative, even disease, cancer, all of those things. Joy in your life rallies your body to face difficult things. And while happiness is by chance, joy is by choice. Joy is an attitude, and an attitude, your attitude is something that you can choose. Attitude is a choice. I'm one who truly believes that one of the most important qualities of life that you can control is your attitude. Charles Swindoll wrote a number of years back a couple sentences, which I find to be fascinating and true. He writes these words. The longer I live, the more I realize the impact on attitude on life. Attitude, Swindoll says, is more important than facts. It's more important than the past, more important than education, than money, than circumstances, than failure, than successes. More important than what other people say or think or say. It's more important than appearance, giftedness, or skill. Attitude can break a company, a church, and a home. The remarkable thing is that we have a choice every day regarding the attitude we will embrace for the day. He says, we cannot change our past. We cannot change the fact that people will behave in a certain way. We cannot change the attitude. The only thing we can do is play on the one string that we have, he says, and that is our attitude. He says, I'm convinced that life is 10% what happens to me, and 90% how I react to it. I just think that sentence is full of wisdom and insight, because attitude is more important than education. You can have a highly educated person but have a bad attitude, and it's not going to solve the problems in front of you. Attitude is a more powerful force than money. I mean, you can have all the money in the world, but it's not going to buy joy in your heart. Some of the most economically poor people have the greatest attitude. Kay and Barb and I have been to Africa. They have nothing, but the joy in their hearts is unbelievable. Attitude is more important than circumstances. I learned long ago that it's not what happens to you that is most important, but how you react to the things that happen to you. Other times you can choose your reaction, over time you can choose your reaction to react to challenges and difficult situations. Over time, when challenges come up, you can choose what your attitude will be in order to get through that challenge. Attitude is also, on the one hand, more important than failure. We've talked before in sermons about people, all kinds of people, who have had tremendous behavior, tremendous failures in life, but kept at it with an attitude and overcame insurmountable odds. Attitude is more important than failure. And at the same time, attitude is more important than success. Success can go to your head and you can lose your drive. All you have to do is think of a successful athlete who has just signed a huge contract, and sometimes their attitude means that their performance goes downhill. Many people, I think, know that life is 10% what happens to you and 90% how you react to what happens to you, because attitude is critical. Today we're talking about the attitude of joy, and I'd like to suggest the secret of joy has to do with choosing an attitude of joy, that inner attitude, that reaction, that attitude that you have with which you approach life, no matter what happens to you, no matter the external circumstances that face you. Today we're going to use sermon notes, which we do every once in a while. It's on the yellow half sheet in your bulletin if you want to take that out and take a pen or pencil. We'll talk about how you get an attitude of joy. Before we begin that, my grandmother, no matter what, would say, "This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it." Whether it was a good day or a bad day, no matter what kind of day it was, when I'd see her in the morning, "This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it." So repeat that with me. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. So how do you get that inner attitude of joy? Number one, jettison regrets about my past. You know, some people go through life with their past like an anchor that just drags them down or inhibits them from moving forward. We all have regrets. We all have regrets. We all have probably skeletons in the closet that we regret doing or saying. No one's perfect. But one of the realities of life is that regrets don't work. Regrets cannot change your past. Instead, regrets only leave you miserable and mired in an if-only wash cycle where you keep going around and around and never get anywhere and never really move forward. The best thing you can do with things that you have regrets about is learn from them. Have those regrets that you have be a learning experience to avoid the kind of behaviors that led to that regret in the first place. God's love and grace and forgiveness is like, about 2 months ago, I used an Etch-a-Sketch. Remember those that, you know, it disappears with God's love, grace, and forgiveness. The first step in living with an attitude of joyfulness is to jettison regrets we have about our past. Learn from them, don't repeat them, but don't be constantly burdened down by regrets about the past. Omit worries about my future. You know, once we jettison regrets about the past, it's important to face the other end of life. If you're going to live with an attitude of joyfulness, in a sense, you have to admit some worries about the future, because worry about what might happen is sometimes the biggest killjoy in life. You can't be joyful and worrisome at the same time. Because one of the ways that worry works in our brains is that it increases our anxiety about our future, and the more anxiety you have, the less you're able to think clearly, and so the more you worry, the more you become reactive, and all of a sudden, molehills turn into mountains that get bigger and bigger in our brains. You can't change the past with regrets. You can't change the future with worrying about things. And so following what the Apostle Paul says is so important. He says, don't worry about things. Instead, pray. Pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank Him for all that He's done. Pray, 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 and then release the outcome of your prayers to God. When you do that, along with jettisoning past regrets, omitting worries about your future, you're another step on to a joyful life. Third, yield. Yield yourself to God's purpose. Yield yourself to God's purpose. Because if you don't have a purpose in life, if you don't know where you came from or where you're going to, you'll just drift through life on autopilot, and you'll substitute happiness, happenstance, for joy, and you'll substitute short-term pleasures for long-term joy. When Paul was in prison, he wrote Philippians. It's the gospel of joy. At the end of his life, he's in prison, and he writes these words, "For me to live is Christ." He begins that letter to the Philippians. He's at the end of his life. He's in prison. He's in poor health. He's lonely. He's living in a dungeon in Rome, being in chains for a Roman guard 24 hours a day. They've taken away everything he has. All of his external circumstances are bad. He's got no friends to comfort him, no ministry to look forward to, no privacy, no freedom. But there's one thing they couldn't take away from him, and that was his purpose in life. He says, you know, for me to live is Christ. If you want to live a joy-filled life, you need to say, God, I give myself to you. I want to put your purpose in my life. Use me, lead me, guide me into your will and way. Four, next, focus on what's good. Focus on what's good, because life, I don't know about for you, but life is often a roller coaster with lots of ups and downs, lots of mountaintop experiences, often followed by deep valleys. Life is full of wins and losses, good times and bad times. That's again what the Apostle Paul says when he says, fix your thoughts on what's true and honorable and right. Think about the things that are pure and lovely and honorable. When the offering is received, the plates will go around, and at the bottom of the plates, there's this little card that is in plastic that, if you'd like, I'd like you to take one. What it says on the top, it says, choose joy. And it says, life can be hard. There's financial trouble, difficult relationships, health problems, death, etc. But every day I have a choice. I can let those things bring me down, or I can choose joy and just be thankful that I'm here. I can choose. Choose joy. So as your offering plate goes around, just there's a number of them at the bottom. Just take those. Keep in your wallet, on your car, on your mirror, whatever you'd like. Next, use my life to help others. When you focus on helping others, you give your life away in serving others, and when you serve others, all of a sudden your problems and aches and pains start to diminish. The more unselfish you are, the more joyful you will become. The more you give your life away, the more you actually will gain it. Paul writes from prison. He says, dear brothers and sisters, I love you and long to see you, for you are my joy and the reward of my work. Paul knew that, even in his state of captivity, that he could use his life to help others, and that years ago, I used the example of an old Native American Cherokee legend of a grandfather who tells his grandson that within each person there's a battle that goes on. He says, the grandfather said, "My son, the battle is between two wolves inside each of us. The first wolf is evil. It's anger, envy, jealousy, sorrow, regret, greed, arrogance, resentment, inferiority, false pride, superiority, and ego. The second wolf at battle within each person," he says, "is good. It's joy and peace and love and hope, serenity, humility, benevolence, empathy, truth, compassion, and faith." The grandson thinks about it for a while, and then he said, "Well, which one wins? Which wolf wins?" And the old Cherokee says, "The one you feed. The one you feed. Feed that inner attitude of joy, love, and serving others, and joy will grow within you." Finally, L, learn to be content. Paul says in prison, you know, suffering through all of the things that he went through, he says, "I've learned to be content whatever the circumstances." He says, "I know what it's like to have little. I know what it's like to have plenty. In all circumstances, I have learned the secret of being well-fed and of going hungry, of having plenty and of being in need. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." What a wonderful verse. Clearly, learning to be content and deciding to be joyful and thankful is something that is very difficult at times because we can get swept up with circumstances, but it's something that we can, each of us, choose to do. Feed the joy. Decide to feed the joy in your life for the rest of your life. Because if you've ever had those times in your life when you're depressed and you're discouraged and you think, "There's got to be more to life than this," you're right. You were created to know and to love and to serve God. You were created by God for a purpose, on purpose. You were made to know the love of Christ and to share that with other people in a life of witness and service. And when you do that, you will experience deep joy and satisfaction in life. And that, dear friends, is the secret of joy. Let's close in prayer. Gracious and loving God, we